5 seconds, 2 seconds, ready. Sir, before I sit down, I want to touch on a third point, and that is about the port protection. As the House is aware, the Central Industrial Security Force Act has been enacted by both Houses of Parliament. I had my own doubts whether it would be applicable to the ports, and I went on hammering the Home Ministry and the Ministry of Shipping to come to a decision about its applicability to the ports of the country. I am happy to announce to the House that in this August House, during the last session, the Honorable Home Minister was pleased to make an announcement that after considering every aspect and taking into consideration everything, the Home Minister had come to the conclusion that the Central Industrial Security Force Act would be applicable to all the ports of India. Port, according to their decision, has been included in the definition of industrial establishments. This is the position of the government. Now, my only request to the Ministry of Transport and Shipping and the various port trusts in India is to take advantage of the Act and try to utilize the CISF, replacing the present watch and ward establishment in the ports, and try to improve the protection facilities available in the ports. Since the major decision has been taken that the ports would be available to the ports, I see no difficulty as to why the ports should not utilize that facility which has been granted to them. Therefore, I would plead with the minister, because he is a dynamic person, to take up things and get things moving, to take up this matter in a more serious manner with the chairman of the Port Trust and prevail upon him to see that the force which would be applicable to the ports is utilized by the ports for the protection of the goods under the charge of the various ports. These are the three things I wanted to raise, utilizing the opportunity of the Calcutta Port Amendment Bill, and I do hope that these will receive due attention to the minister, and that the assurance which has not been fulfilled for 7 years will soon be fulfilled. Sir, as I said in the beginning, this is a very simple measure under which we propose to take some power so that the Calcutta port may be able to construct that bridge or some part of that bridge on behalf of the state government as far as that is concerned. Practically everybody has supported it, and everybody has supported the powers which we are taking in this bill. Regarding other things, my friend has told so many things about the second Hooghly Bridge. This was a long story, and regarding that, it was decided last year that we should construct a second bridge. For that purpose, the central government has agreed to give a non-plan loan for the construction of the bridge proper and its immediate appropriate. सर आई वेलकम दिस बिल रिगार्डिंग द टेक ओवर ऑफ द कंपनी लास्ट टाइम व्हाइल डिस्कसिंग द थिंकिंग ओवर ऑफ द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ बर्न्ड एंड कंपनी लिमिटेड एंड इंडियन स्टैंडर्ड वैगन कंपनी लिमिटेड आई हैड मेंशन्ड सम ऑफ द पॉइंट्स देयर डिफिकल्टीज एंड द रेमेडीज देयर ऑफ Sir, on the floor of this house, we have been mostly hearing that public sector projects are running at a loss. We should go deep into the whole problem and find out the differences in running of a public sector project and a private sector project and the reasons therefore. I can cite 2 or 3 examples where public sector projects are doing very well. Sir, let us look at the problem from different angles, from the angle of management, from the angle of labor, from the angle of raw materials, etc. You will find that there are several factors which are responsible for the difference in the working of a public sector project and a private sector project. Let us first of all take management. On the management side, we find that public sector has got certain limitations about payment of salaries of supervisors and workers and so on. Now, these limitations are not present in a private sector project. A private sector organization can offer its 2 officers a salary of ₹4,000, a house rent of ₹2,000, car allowance of another ₹1,000, and an entertainment allowance of ₹25,000, and so on. A private sector organization can, in fact, offer much more than what a public sector organization can offer. In the present day world, we have got a competitive market for everything. Duly qualified talent and technical hands run to private sector projects. Now this anomaly will have to be stopped, it will have to be curtailed. There must be a ceiling on the salaries, benefits and perquisites of both the public sector and private sector management. A public sector organization can offer its top man only say ₹3,000. These things should be looked into very closely by the government. I sincerely hope that government will soon come forward with legislation providing for a ceiling on the salaries, perquisites and total allowance of persons doing same type of work in similar organizations. Until and unless we do that, I am afraid better type of boys or better type of talent will always go to the private sector and will not be available to the public sector. Secondly, sir, I come to raw materials. In the raw materials, we find that most of the time the public sector is running short of raw materials. During certain periods, they go dry, the plants remain idle, but the private sector has an advantage because the private sector go
at once in the black market and they can purchase at whatever the current price. They can buy all the raw materials in order to keep their plants feeding and they keep them moving.